How do you find your way in a challenging and often hostile world? Best-selling author Wes Moore has his own amazing answer. He'll discuss it next on Global Perspectives.
This is Global Perspectives with Pulitzer Prize-winning commentator John Bercia.
Welcome to Global Perspectives. Poverty, inequality, drugs, and other challenges can place the American dream out of reach. Not so for Wes Moore, author of The Other Wes Moore. But even as he lives the dream, he remembers and works with those who have not yet achieved it. Welcome to the show, Wes.
It's my honor, John. Thank you so much.
It's a thrill to have you here. Everybody's heard of the book, so I think we have to start with the book. Tell us a little bit about it, especially in terms of where you were when you were first inspired to write it.
So the Other Wes Moore is a book really about both my life and the life of another gentleman. And I first learned about Wes when one day I was just receiving the Rhodes Scholarship, so I was getting ready to head off to England, and the Baltimore Sun, which is my hometown paper, wrote this article about this local kid who just received this award. And in the article, they talked a bit about my life, my childhood, and the fact that I grew up in a single-parent household, the fact that we did not have it easy, nor did I make a lot of very good decisions when I was coming up, but how through a lot of intervention, a lot of support, and a lot of people who genuinely believed in second chances, I was able to help change the azimuth of my life a little bit. And now here I was receiving this award. But at the same time, they're writing a whole series of articles about these four gentlemen who walked into a jewelry store and ended up murdering an off-duty police officer in a botched robbery.
And two of them were brothers.
And two of them were brothers. And one of the brothers was a guy whose name was also Wes Moore. And so I knew there were questions I wanted to ask, and Wes was the only one that could answer it. As I'm sitting there, and I found out really that we had so much more in common than just our names. We are from the same city, literally times blocks away from each other. Both grew up in single-parent households. Both grew up, with school challenges, with challenges in criminal justice system. And I decided that I wanted to reach out to him and ask him some questions. And I wrote him this note in prison. And a month later, I got a letter back from Jessup Correctional Institution from Wes. And at that time, he was, a few years into his life sentence. He received a life sentence for the crime. And that one letter turned to dozens of letters. Those dozens of letters turned into dozens of visits. And I've now known Wes for close to a decade. And
wow.
And so what one thing, when we really started thinking about, is what is here, I'd known Wes for years before even the idea of the book came about. And I remember I have a friend, a woman named Terry Williams, and she's an author. And she does a lot of work with the adult people in the adult prison system. I do a lot of work with kids in the juvenile justice system. And she said to me, she's like, I really think you should write about this. And I told her, I said, Terry, I'm not a writer. I don't have time to write a book. I'm not that interested in digging that deeply into his life or digging that deeply and sharing about my own life. And that's when she reminded me of two things. She said, one, she reminded me of a quote by a gentleman named Edmund Burke. And Edmund Burke once said, all it takes for evil to triumph is for good people to do nothing. And then I thought about something that Wes told me. When I asked Wes his thoughts and his opinion, he said, I've wasted every opportunity that I've ever had in here. And if you can do something to help people think differently about the consequences for their decisions, but also do something to help people think about the neighborhoods that these decisions are being made in, then you should do it. And that really became the fire and the focus behind this entire project.
Did you ever talk to him about his initial reaction when he first received your letter? Did he think it was a joke, or was he confused?
Well, it's funny because I wasn't even sure what to expect. I wasn't sure he'd write back. Because I put myself, you kind of put yourself in his shoes. I'm like, okay, I'm sitting there and, in a maximum security facility for life. And I get a letter from someone saying, hey, Wes, my name is Wes. Here's how I heard about you. I'm not even sure if I would ever respond to that letter. But the letter that he wrote was so fascinating. Because first, it was one of the most interesting and articulate letters I've ever received. He's made some really bad and horrific and unforgiving decisions in his life. But he's no dummy. I mean, he's a smart guy, which I think really compounds a lot of the tragedy of the decisions that he has made, that he'll even say that. But the other thing that I know was after getting that letter back from him, he systematically then responded to every single question that I asked. But the first thing he wrote in the response letter was, he said, thank you for writing me, because when you're in here, you think that the whole world doesn't think you even exist anymore. And so it was very eye-opening to have a much clearer understanding of where he is and what his day is, what his life is, and what position that he's put himself in.
And I remember reading that at one time he was a very good student.
Yes, he was a very good student. Even what's ironic, that even after he you know, had left school, because he dropped out, you know, midway of his sophomore year in high school. But he then got involved in the juvenile justice system again, got involved in a program called Job Corps. And Job Corps is a federal program, and really actually pretty outstanding program, where students who might be opportunity youth, they're not in school and they're not employed, and many of whom do not even have high school degrees, but they can go through this program called Job Corps, where it'll teach them a skill, they'll get them academic certifications and credentialing, and then put them on a better path to be able to have a life of, you know, of both progress and contribution. And while Wes was in Job Corps, he learned a few things about himself. First of all, he got his GED. He realized he was reading at a sophomore in college reading level. This is a person that never made it past 10th grade, was reading at a sophomore in college reading level, was very good with his hands, you know, did woodwork, did a bunch of collection of other things. And it really gave him an opportunity for a second chance. But I think, you know, one of the tragedies that we saw, though, was even after he left the Job Corps and he tried to get back into the job market, and this is something I think we as a large society have to wrestle with, is that when you come out with a felony record, you don't have many employment opportunities. Mm-hmm. And the one thing that we know, and this is just human nature for anybody, is you're gonna figure out a way to take care of your family. You'll figure out a way to eat, you'll figure out a way to make money. Unfortunately, they're not always things that are redeeming, and they're not always things that are beneficial for society. And I think Wes made a decision, and it was his decision, but I think even as he says, one of the worst decisions he could have made when he was working various odd jobs and could not hold down long-term employment. And eventually he decided to go back to the corners. Mm-hmm. And even as he said, it was the worst decision that I could have made.
And under different circumstances, you might have followed a similar path, but you went to military school, and do we credit your mother as being the main force behind that?
I do, and one thing I try to emphasize in stories is the chilling truth is that his story could have been mine. Mm-hmm. The tragedy is that my story could have been his.
Right.
And one thing that I know is, you know, I'm blessed to have my mother. You know, I think I always say that I think the greatest blessing I've ever gotten was one that I had zero to do with, and that's the fact that Joy Moore is my mother. But I also do know, though, that my mother doesn't love us a drop more than Wes's mother loves her kids. That Wes's mother bleeds for her children. But I think it's really important to understand that, you know, to understand the lives of these two kids, it's important not just to look at the lives of these two kids. Take it a generation back. Take it back to the mothers. Take it back to both of these two women who are now propelled to raise these kids on their own, both my mother and Wes's mother, and for different reasons. But this was their reality, and I also know that other things matter. You know, housing matters, support systems matter, education matters. I look at Wes's mom. Wes's mom was the first one in her family to go to college. You know, she graduated from Baltimore City Community College with honors, and then got accepted to Johns Hopkins University. And while she's
no small feat,
right? And then does two semesters at Johns Hopkins. And after her second semester at Johns Hopkins, she receives a note indicating that her Pell Grants were cut. Hmm. You know, what people, and she knew at that point, she was barely making it by with the Pell Grant place. Once that's gone, she can't afford it. And while some people might say, well, it's only a couple thousand here, a couple thousand there, whatever the case might be, we underestimated just how many kids that we're talking about, where that couple thousand is a difference between them continuing and them not. And I can't help but think how different her life could have been had she had the chance to finish college, had she had the chance to finish her education. I think so much of the work that we do now around college completion and career placement solely goes back to this understanding that I know what a college a degree can do to someone, how it transforms not just their life, but it can transform their family.
Mm-hmm.
These things matter, and how we think about them and how we what we put in place to actually make it real for them has real consequences.
For those who don't know the entire story, could you share a little bit about your initial reaction when you arrived at the academy?
Yes. So my mother had been threatening me with military school ever since I was 8 years old, because pretty early I started, literally picking and choosing which days were worthwhile to go to school. Became truant, got involved in the juvenile justice system. I mean, I first had handcuffs on my wrist when I was 11 years old, and when I was 13, was when my mom told me, after years of threats, I'm staying in military school. And at first, I was kind of like, military school? Like, I don't know what that is. I mean, I'm not going.
She was bluffing?
I thought she was bluffing. I was like, I'm not going to military school. I'm not going away. And finally, she told me, start packing your stuff up. And she sent me to a military school in Pennsylvania. And when I first got there, I made it clear to anyone who would listen to me that I'm not staying. Like, you are wasting your time yelling at me. You're wasting your time screaming at me. You're wasting your time trying to teach me anything. Because I'm really going to be here probably for another 24 to 48 hours, and I'm gone. And they had these big black gates that surrounded the school. And every time they would turn their backs, I would just run out of the gates. Because I was running trying to find this train station they kept on telling us about. They said, there's a train station right in Wayne. You can go anytime you want. So I would just take them up on their offer and try to find this train station.
And you ran away four times?
Five times in the first four days.
I was going to say in the first week
or
so.
That's right. And they caught me in the middle of the woods one night. And because they had actually drawn me a map on how to get to the train station, the map was fake. They just wanted to laugh and watch me doing circles in the woods. And when they found me, they brought me back to campus. And we weren't allowed any outside communication, phone calls, radios, television, nothing. But they said, we know if we don't do something, we're going to lose them.
So they let you call your mother?
They said, you can make one phone call. You got 5 minutes. And I called. I called mom, and I asked her to come get me, come bring me home. I don't like it here. I'm not doing well here. And she eventually told me, she's like, I'm not coming to get you. This is where you need to be, and too many people have fought and sacrificed and are rooting for you. And we all just want you to give it a shot. And it took a while. It was no overnight thing. But eventually, I just tried to do that. And by the end of the first year, I was doing a little better academically. I could play sports because it wasn't a probation. And I felt like for the first time, when people asked my mom, how's Wes doing? She could say, he's doing all right, and not be lying. Mm-hmm. And that actually meant something, and it felt good.
Tell us about your reaction to a disciplined environment, because so many people come from undisciplined environment. In fact, it's against what we practice as Americans. We want to make our own choices, but there's something about a disciplined environment that teaches you about respect.
There's something that teaches you about respect. There's something that teaches you about boundaries. There's something that also teaches you, ironically, about independence and leadership. That's actually one of the interesting blessings of discipline and a disciplined environment, where people think it's contracting, mm-hmm. where people think it's suffocating. Actually, it's actually incredibly freeing, because what it does then, it teaches you how to explore things in creative and entrepreneurial and fearless ways that I think a lot of people don't appreciate and wouldn't fully grasp unless you had a chance to taste it that way. I think about the input of leadership into my life and how important leadership was for everything that that happened to me. I mean, people say, well, what was one of the best things about military school? And it's not that military school was an answer, like the catch-all, but I do know one thing that became really important was this introduction of leadership into your life. And one thing I know with so many of the kids, even that we work with now to this day, kids are going to learn. The question is, what are they learning and who are they learning from? But they're going to learn. And I think one thing that happened to me that military school was able to do a good job of instilling early was this is how you should be thinking about your life. This is what you should be thinking about in terms of the azimuth and direction that of the things that you hope to accomplish and get out of your own life. Had it not been for that, had it not been for this graduated sense of responsibility, had it not been for people helping me to see that the world is bigger than what's directly in front of me, I think things could have been fundamentally very, very different.
And a lot of people tend to define achievement in very, very narrow terms. And
Completely.
I'm sure the other Wes Moore thought his brother was successful and had respect, and he did in a certain context. But that wasn't the kind of thing that was going to carry him very far in life.
That's right. And, so it's interesting, actually, I'm a new book project that I'm working on now is called The Work. It's done, it's getting released in January, but it kind of asks that question about, so if the other Wes Moore is about that journey into adulthood, The Work is about what happens next. You know, now that we've made it, how do we make it matter? How do we make that lesson of life and our time here on this planet matter? And really what one of the things I found is that kind of that common bond, that thread, is service, is understanding that we are all living, every one of us are living for something bigger than just ourselves. And so I tell not just the stories of what happened in my life since 2000, kind of, you know, the adventures and misadventures in many cases, but then I also highlight about 9 different people who I feel like some private sector, some public sector, some government, some military, some education, some media, but all people who have found their point and all people who have found their purpose and how that translates into redefining success. That success doesn't have to mean some mercenary endeavor. Success doesn't have to mean something where we're constantly keeping score. You know, success simply means that when you find that point of your greatest gifts and the world's greatest hurt, when they meet, and when you actually are then prepared to do something about it. That is that definition of success.
And a lot of what you're talking about, if I can switch and put my global hat on for a few minutes, a lot of what you're talking about would apply in much the same way on the global plane. Because, you know, inequality, poverty, lack of education, et cetera, and you end up with the same kind of results.
Absolutely. I mean, these are not an American phenomena. The dynamic of disparities, the dynamic of gaps, educational gaps, digital gaps, expectation gaps. These are not American dynamics alone. And I think you're absolutely right, is not only do we need to understand that these are global conversations, that other countries are involved in these conversations as well, but we also have to understand what our role is in that global conversation, that it isn't just about our levels and then the levels of everybody else, but it's about how exactly and what becomes our role. What is our burden? What is our obligation? What is our cherished beauty of being a true global partner and a true global citizen? These things can actually be addressed, that they can actually be thought about, and these successes can actually be achieved as long as it's something that we're willing to endeavor and as long as it's something that we're bold enough and brave enough to actually go after.
Now, this may not be a fair question given what you've just talked about, but as a Rhodes Scholar and during your experiences in the military and traveling to other parts of the world, is there one key experience that you had, one relationship that you forged that really, really transformed you?
Now that is a challenging question. I tell you one incident that really, it refreshes the understanding of the human spirit and the power of one. And that was, and especially thinking about on the international and global scale, I was in South Africa and I was doing a study abroad in South Africa and I was living in Langa, which is a part of Cape Town. And it was one of the oldest townships in South Africa. And the townships, for those who don't know, these are places where, especially during apartheid South Africa, where you took a lot of the black South Africans and had them in these township areas. Langa was one of the largest and one of the oldest in the country. And I was living with a family out there, and they were Xhosa, which is a traditional one of the tribes in South Africa. And as I was with them, they were telling me all these amazing stories about apartheid and the apartheid era. And actually their husband was actually imprisoned and taken away for a very long time, came back and was never the same after he came back. And so I would hear Mama, my homestay mother, tell these stories. And I had to interrupt her and I said, I'm so sorry. Like, how do you forgive out of all this? She had the most forgiving soul. And I was like, how, after all this stuff that you're telling me, can you just openly wake up one morning and just say, it's okay, and forgive? And her answer was so complex and simple and beautiful all at the same time, when she just looks at me and she says, because President Mandela asked us to. That simple. You know, this is a person who was incarcerated, you know, for over 30 years, but in Robben Island alone for 27, came out partially blind because they had him chopping lime while he was in the prison, which basically continued to burn his eyes. If anybody had a right to be angry, it was him. And quite honestly, if you look at where, if you talk to most political scientists in 1980, and you said, you know, in 10 years, there's one country that I'm going to tell you the name of is going to be a flourishing democracy, one of the real economic engines of the continent. The other one will be a kleptocracy where their currency is the value of wallpaper. One is South Africa, one is Zimbabwe. And you ask most political scientists, they would have gotten that wrong in 1980. They would have said Zimbabwe would have been the flourishing country because they had all the resources and such. And South Africa would be an utter mess because even after apartheid lifted, you still have dozens of tribes that would then start fighting for power. It's impossible to understand the peaceful transition that South Africa made without understanding the impact of human resolve. And that human resolve had to have a leader. And that leader was Nelson Mandela.
What are some of the other issues that trouble you when you look at the world? And do you also, you know, see some of these things and view them with optimism?
Well, first, I don't think there's anything that I don't view with optimism.
Okay, well, that's good.
I don't think I'm built that way, and I wouldn't want to be built any other way. I think that if we don't have a sense of optimism, if we don't have a sense of hope in our hearts, then why are we here? So we have very real challenges. I think we have to do a better job of addressing what's happening with our environment. I think we have to do a better job of addressing what's happening with our criminal and specifically our juvenile justice system, because I think we're watching far too many good souls that are making bad decisions and are never able to rebound or recoup from them. And we're losing a lot of long-term assets by the way in the structure that we have things laid out. I think we have to do a better job with our education system, and not just our K-12, but also with higher ed. And we need to put a much clearer focus on completion and also career placement. So there's a lot of things that I'm like, you know, if I could wave a wand and say we fix it, we'd fix it. I know that's not possible, and that anything worth it is going to take hard work, but that's part of the beauty of us being here. If we're not ready and willing to work hard, then why else would we be here?
I have to ask you one more question.
Of course.
You have all of the capabilities of someone who could lead a nation. Is this something that is part of your agenda, dream, et cetera?
I absolutely have an ambition to be a leader in our nation. I also don't feel like it has to come with a job title, though. I know people that don't have big titles that are doing absolutely amazing things on this planet. And I know people with very big titles that do absolutely nothing. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I always say, you know, I love my job and I don't want anybody else's. I know that impact, real impact, doesn't have a job description. It just has proof points. And my goal is hitting proof points and not necessarily trying to get a certain job, because I don't think that, you know, good work and a certain business card always equate in the same way.
And everywhere you go, you probably inspire just about everyone in your audience. Have there been particular cases where young people have come up to you and mentioned how much you affected them, and then you maintained some kind of correspondence with them?
Absolutely. It's one of my favorite things. It's one of the reasons why I love specifically working with students, and whether they be middle school students or elementary school students or high school students or college students or grad students. You know, we've built a pretty sizable and powerful army of young people who are just absolutely on fire. And whether it be for the student that comes up and says, you know, listen, this is the first book that I've ever read cover to cover, because it spoke to me, or whether it's someone who says, I knew after reading this that I needed to speak differently to my friend, my cousin, my brother, my sister, my parents, whatever the case is, or whether it's just the person who said, I've learned not to put limitations on what I can do. That stuff is really inspiring to me. And one thing I believe, and I always say, is that for anybody who is about the business of doing good things for other people, I would be honored to be your wingman.
Good. Well, thank you so much for joining us today, Wes Moore.
Thank you, John. It's my honor. Thank you.
Thank you. And thank you. For Global Perspectives, I'm John Bercia, and we'll see you next time.